It's our third show. Can you believe it? 3 days already. Therapy Cable Live has been on. Top news we're going to be talking about today, a little bit about the State of the Union address Barack Obama did yesterday on Tuesday. We've also got some very interesting psychological topics to discuss. We're going to look at the unconscious world of the human mind. We're going to take a brief look, but I'm hoping to expand this on each and every episode from now on. We're going to look at the influences and how they affect our perception in life, as well as how we make decisions. So today, we're going to take a fascinating look at high heels. Do they influence how a man behaves? Well, you're going to find out. We're also going to look at a drinkable book. I'm telling you, it's an amazing day. We're going to talk to the model Emma Hernan, and we're going to talk to Professor Timani a little later on this afternoon as well about a thing called Takfir. What did you say? Takfir. What is it? You're going to find out. So stay tuned. Welcome to Therapy Cable Live. A unique and provocative look at today's current events. We provide the answers and a better understanding of the world around you. Therapy Cable Live. Welcome back, everyone. So we're going to be discussing high heels. You say, Carlos? We'll get to that in a minute. But before we do that, I want to talk very briefly about the State of the Union address last night from Barack Obama. And I'm going to be honest about you about this. It's not just him. A lot of presidents, politicians, and diplomats will do this little tactic, which is actually kind of funny. Let's see. One of the things I focused on yesterday is he talked about how we have to work together. The country has to work together to make a better future. Of course, it always sounds nice. But what does that mean? And that's something you'll hear a lot from politicians, platitudes and generalities. There's no specifics. What does work together mean? Republicans, Democrats get along together? What does that mean? Do they have to agree on all the bills? Do they have to prevent somebody from stopping a bill? So definitions and clarity are really important. And you're not going to get that, especially in an address. Here's one I really wanted to highlight, though. President Obama said, he's tired of the rhetoric and that it's bad for the country, especially the one about how our country is getting weaker and our enemies are getting stronger. But then he follows up. This is a very classic logical fallacy. He follows up with, America is the strongest nation in the world. Not even close, he says. So let's break that apart quickly here. He's absolutely right. America is the strongest nation in the world, and it isn't even close. Economically, militarily. Absolutely right. We spend the most of any country in the world on the military. But here's the catch. What did he originally say? He's tired of the rhetoric that America is getting weaker and the enemy is getting stronger. So let's put that right here. Then he says America is the strongest country in the world. Those are two different things, people. You can still be the number one, and you can still get weaker while your opponents are getting stronger. You see where that argument doesn't really make sense? They can actually both work together. But he was trying to describe it as they're totally different. That this actually was fallacious, that America was getting weaker and the enemy stronger because we're number one in the world. See how he did that? Kind of clever. Politicians will try to do that all the time, playing with words. Logical fallacies like those are tricky, right? Because we don't see it. We don't hear it, actually, better said. We don't hear them clearly. We have to really, really pay attention. And of course, it always sounds great when he says, your country in particular, when he says America is the strongest country in the world. It's the best country in the world. Of course that is. Isn't that a fantastic feeling if you're an American? Absolutely. So, pretty bad argumentation tactic there by Obama. Hopefully a lot of you caught that. It was kind of tricky, but they'll do that a lot. Politicians will talk this way. They'll use generalities. They'll use these false arguments. It's a false equivalent argument. There's nothing there. There's no connection to those two. So keep in mind of that the next time you hear an address. Actually, tomorrow night on the GOP debate, you're probably going to hear a lot of these things. Listen for that, especially between Rubio. Unfortunately, Paul won't be there, but Rubio and Cruz and some of the other candidates, I'm trying to think who else is pretty clever with these things. Christie, you're going to hear them using these little tactics, what we call logical fallacies in argumentation and debate class. You're going to hear them. You're going to hear these segues that make no sense or arguments against somebody else's arguments that make no sense or are not relevant at all. I remember an argument Rubio had with Rand Paul. Rand Paul was attacking Rubio on his immigration stance, And Rubio flipped it into being an issue of isolationism for Rand Paul. I wish I had the clip. I could show it to you next time. We can analyze that further. We will be taking more of a look at how politicians try to, I don't know if you say deceive us, but try to trick us with their words. At the same time, we'll also look at media bias because they're doing the same thing to us all. He's cut these headlines, he edit these clips, and everything just doesn't look right. So stay tuned for more of that fun stuff. And in a few minutes, we're going to start looking at the unconscious and how it really influences our life in a lot of ways. We're going to find out how do we really pick a presidential candidate. But before that, let's take a brief break, and then we're going to look at how high heels influence us. So take a look at this commercial and get right back to us.
Welcome to Adelante. This is Adelante Recovery, and my name is Yvette Kuglin, and I'm part of the staff.
Adelante Recovery Center has helped people in dual diagnosis for 5 years. We accept most PPO insurances and provide luxury accommodations and 24-hour support. To speak with an admissions counselor, call 1-888-242-4450.
A lot of time we don't even know what's wrong with us, and sometimes we need to get away to figure that out. So if you want to go for a little retreat out in Corona Del Mar, which is a confidential location, we're here to help. So we're only a phone call away. Thank you.
Welcome back, everyone. So let's get to that segment. I'm sure a lot of you are wondering about what in the world is Dr. Carlos talking about now. We're going to talk about high heels and how they influence men. But let's first watch this video on the career, one of the biggest fashion designers on hot heels. Take a look.
Well, if you love high heels, and who doesn't, the man we're about to meet needs little introduction. Christian Louboutin is a high saint, maybe even a deity in the Church of Fine Footwear. If you don't worship at the altar of the stiletto, then you'll want to know two things about his shoes. A pair costs more than household appliances, and the soles are always a flagrant, flirtatious red. Here's ABC's Sharon Alfonsi.
From the back of a Vespa, you can learn a lot about someone. Darting in and out of traffic through Paris on his red Vespa, it is clear, my driver is fearless. And while few women might recognize his face, his soul, that soul, is now one of the most recognized in the world.
I'm impressed.
Christian Louboutin. Yes, that Louboutin. The designer behind these sexy, skyscraping, signature red-soled shoes. A staple of sirens from Angelina Jolie to Scarlett Johansson. The pump of powerhouses and pop stars like Jennifer Lopez.
I would like a shiny new pair of Louboutin shoes. You know, the ones with the high heels and the red bottoms?
Who sings the shoes' praises with her song, Louboutin.
I'm throwing on my Louboutins, I'm throwing on my Louboutins.
Women line up for his sexy shoes outside his Paris store. But he has a very specific customer in mind.
So you'd rather have a call girl in here than a woman who lunches?
I quite like my customer to be fierce.
Yeah, fierce.
More, yeah, exactly.
A little raunchy.
Exactly.
When Louboutin isn't practicing his sky-high trapeze routine,
so this is the atelier.
He's designing sky-high shoes here at his atelier in Paris.
Most of things here are custom-made shoes.
Custom-made shoes. So this is a custom shoe of some lucky lady.
Mm-hmm.
He makes no apologies for those sky-high prices. His shoes sell from anywhere from about $500 to $6,000. Today, Louboutin sells more than 600,000 pairs a year.
A good shoe is exactly like a good wine, quality. These shoes are going to stay on the last for a long time.
Louboutin started sketching shoes as a teen. Kicked out of school at 16, he spent nights in Paris designing shoes for burlesque showgirls. He launched his own company in 1991, but just 3 years later, a happy accident. The prototype of a shoe he created had come in, but it seemed to be lacking something.
I had a girl working with me trying on the shoes, so when she was not trying on shoes, she sort of had nothing to do, so she was sort of waiting. And so she was doing her nails, so she had this nail polish, and I thought, well, this black has to disappear. So I grabbed her nail polish and painted the sole.
With the nail polish.
With the nail polish.
The famous red sole was born. Today, he says those red soles attract men the way a bull's attracted to a red cape. But the red sole has also attracted something else. Copycats. Labutin is now embroiled in a nasty lawsuit, suing one designer who started painting his soles red to stop.
To be copied can be sort of taken as a compliment. But when it's to be really attacked in a way,
I do not see it
as a compliment.
A lawyer for UC Laurent said, no designer should monopolize a color. Did you feel that you were monopolizing a color?
I do not monopolize a color. I have put a color at a place where nobody has put it. Hermès is monopolizing the orange with their bag, or Tiffany has a blue.
But it's your trademark.
It is my trademark, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
A trademark that's also viewed as a piece of art. This new book details 20 years of designs, page after page of pure shoe porn. And watching women slip on his shoes is a study in psychology.
Some women are not completely comfortable with their body. And even if you're not really comfortable with your body, you are comfortable with your feet.
The feet always hold up.
6 months pregnant, feeling less than glamorous, he proved it to me.
Roar. Hey. So this is the lion paw. Hello, lovers. Yes. I think I just lost 5 pounds in 10 years. Fabulous. That's high, huh?
You would have to have a half a size smaller.
Really?
Yep.
Comfort does not appear to be part of the Louboutin lexicon. Some stilettos are 7 inches high.
I don't want these shoes to appear as comfortable shoes.
They're not meant to be Birkenstocks.
Exactly.
Okay.
With all the respect that I have for
Birkenstocks. With all respect for Birkenstocks.
This is Python.
Sex, he says, is behind most of his designs. One customer commissioned him to make a shoe for his wife with rubies all over the sole.
Like that. I said, well, you know, but once you have the weight of the person, you realize that it's going to pop up. Yeah. He says there won't be any weight. And it will only be worn in an horizontal way. You don't have to think of vertical.
In a horizontal way?
Yeah. These are the shoes that we did first.
After my tour of shoe heaven and a Vespa ride through Paris, like so many other women, I was convinced Labutin just might be my soulmate. For Nightline, I'm Sharon Alfonsi in Paris.
Welcome back, everyone. Wasn't that a fascinating tidbit? Well, let's look at some of the psychological aspects of high heels and how it does influence male behavior. So take a look at this. Believe it or not, women need not to go out all out to turn heads. All they really need to do is put their best on, actually the highest, according to an article in Psychology Today and a series of experiments described in the archives of sexual behavior. Men's willingness to help a female stranger and eagerness to approach her in a bar increased, get this, with the height of her heels. High heels may enhance a woman's attractiveness by accentuating her movements, including hip motion. According to psychologist Nicholas Guigan, and lead men to overestimate her sexual interest. If you look at the chart, you can see the woman's heel height definitely had a correlation of the stranger's help, willingness to help, as well as their eagerness to approach her. Look at the second column. Well, actually, look at the first column in the second row. You'll see percentage of men who picked up her dropped glove with 0-inch heels was 62%. When the heels went up to 2 inches, it was 78%. And here's the kicker, everybody. 93% of the men were eager to help when their heels were 3.5 inches. Not only that, the ones who approached her, even the time changed. When it was 0 inches, it took 13.5 minutes before a man approached to make contact with the female at a bar. When the heels were 2 inches, it took 11.5 minutes. When the heels were 3.5 inches, it took 7.5 minutes. That's really amazing. That's our unconscious mind. Just because of the size of the heel, it affects how the males acted. Now, of course, one of the caveats you have to remember when it comes to psychological studies or any kind of studies, this is not an absolute, right? It's the probability. So it's a higher probability. For instance, if you were going to wear high heels, that you're going to have a man who's going to help with anything you've dropped or help you and eager to help or help as well as increase the chance they're going to make contact with you at a bar. So it can influence male behavior. That's amazing. We're going to continue looking at unconscious behavior now with our candidate's pick. How do we pick a presidential candidate? What are the psychological influences that we don't even know about that are going to change our view, our perception, and our decision-making capabilities when we choose a presidential candidate. Think about it. We're 10 months away, or actually a little less than 10 months away, before our general election for the president of the most powerful country in the world, the United States of America. And it's coming in less than 10 months. So you want to make the best and most informed decision, but not everybody will. But before we get to some of those factors that influence how we make decisions, let's take a quick look at body language. And then I'll explain a little bit how the body language of presidential candidates can also influence your choice making. Take a look at this.
A big moment during this debate regarding what Donald Trump said in Rolling Stone magazine about Carly Fiorina, her looks slash persona. Let's listen.
I think women all over this country heard very clearly what Mr. Trump said.
I think she's got a beautiful face, and I think she's a beautiful woman.
He's saying, there you go, I made my apology. And she's saying with the pursed lips and the shut eyes, I'm not buying it. So she's signaling her disapproval, but in a very subtle way.
Donald Trump's body language is the opposite, the complete opposite of subtle.
He said he wouldn't want, quote, such a hothead with his finger on the nuclear codes. You as well have raised concerns about Mr. Trump's
casino gambling in Florida.
I didn't want
Yes, you did.
Totally false.
Okay, Donald Trump, his arms, his face. I mean, he makes so many faces in these debates. I would think you would coach people not to do stuff like that.
The standard wisdom in the political world is you're dignified, you look presidential, you don't make faces like that. But Trump's making it work. And I think the reason it's working is because he's coming across as authentic. What you see is what you get.
This confrontation between Trump and Jeb Bush is, I was sure, quite remarkable for you to watch and our viewers too.
States. I was a businessman. I got along with Clinton. I got along with everybody. Yeah. That was my job, to get along with people.
But the simple
I didn't
fact
wanna,
is...
Excuse me. One second.
No.
I
the
didn't want to...
The simple fact is, Donald, you
good.
Cannot take...
More energy tonight. I like
no.
that.
The relationship between this man and this man during this time, the faces they're each making, told you a lot, didn't it?
Yeah, there's so many things going on. So Trump is still rising above the situation in the sense that he feels free to comment on Mr. Bush's energy while this exchange is going on. What he should have done was, first of all, get genuinely angry or more powerfully angry. He gives a fake smile, which is what people do who are uncomfortable with anger.
You remember the rubble? You remember the firefighter with his arms around it? He sent a clear signal that the United States would be strong and fight Islamic terrorism, and he did keep us safe.
TV sound down, you could see his face looks angry. Was that natural? Was that effective for Jeb Bush?
I think this was one of Mr. Bush's good moments. He finally gets angry, and I guess it took dissing his brother to make him angry.
You thought Marco Rubio was stronger in this debate, stronger than the first one.
You better be able to lead our country on the first day.
He's doing two of the four facial gestures that are positive and engaging and that connect with people. He's raising his eyebrows and he's opening his eyes. And that's difficult to do with the bright light shining in your eyes on TV.
A lot of us from New Jersey are outgoing. We're out there, okay? Chris Christie's one of them.
I'm as entertained as anyone by this personal back and forth about the history of Donald and Carly's career. I got to tell you the truth, they could care less about your careers.
When somebody focuses their emotion with anger or excitement or happiness, then we pay attention. And so we're paying attention to Christy here with the lowered eyebrows and the scowl.
Who did the best in the second debate?
In terms of body language alone, I think Rubio, Fiorina, and Christy had the strongest performances. I think Trump held his own.
Well, welcome back, everybody. That was pretty fascinating, I think, the body language, because that actually does influence how we perceive these individuals. And it's fascinating that the gentleman said that Rubio and Fiorina had the best body language in the debate. Because think about it, what were they like? They were kind of rigid, weren't they? A little stiff, very non-expressive, so we really couldn't tell what they were thinking all the time. We did notice when Trump made the, I don't know if you want to call it an apology, but she closed her eyes, and we noticed the body language expert talked about that. I don't think she was really accepting of it. She probably thought it was fake, maybe even condescending. I don't know. We don't know what's really going on in her head. But body language does affect us. I remember in the very first debate, Rand Paul was very hostile. And a lot of people talked to me about it later, saying how petulant he looked and how irritable he seemed. and this actually affected their perception of him, just by the body language. That's truly amazing. At the same time, people talked about Trump when he looks angry, but sometimes he looked aloof during the presentations. But here's one of my pet peeves that I noticed was John Kasich. Why is it a pet peeve? Because it really irritated me when you had a candidate up there that was constantly on the move. See how that bothered you? Well, trust me, it bothers me. And it bothered a lot of other people who watched it. Kasich seemed to be very unsettled, very anxious. I don't know what was going on. Some people said he had coffee before he went to the stage. That could explain a lot of it. But body language is important in how we perceive people. So let's get to it. What are some of the unconscious factors that influences us on picking a presidential candidate? One of the things, believe it or not, the majority of the candidates that do win are tall. That's right. They're taller than their opponents. So Barack Obama, Mitt Romney, if I remember correctly, Obama was taller than Romney. Obama was definitely taller than McCain. So we look at these competitions. Now, once again, the caveat stands. It doesn't mean every time. Because we always get somebody who's going to tweet or call us and say, well, not about this person. There are always anomalies, especially in life. But the majority of the time, according to the studies, showed that the taller candidate usually won the presidency. I know what you're going to do now. Tomorrow night, you're going to be looking at the GOP debate. Who's the tallest candidate? We'll find out. I get the funny feeling, I think Trump was second. I think Jeb Bush is actually a little bit taller. I don't remember. We will take a look at that tomorrow. Unfortunately, right now, the polls do not show Jeb benefiting from his height. Another factor is going to be trust and confidence. And this is trust and confidence exuding from the candidate. Right now, most people view Donald Trump as being a very, very confident person. And I guess you could almost say it's part of charisma. So Trump obviously shows a lot of strength and confidence. Can you trust him? I don't know. That's something he didn't score very high on in some of the polls that I've read over the last couple of months. Other candidates scored better than others. But the question is this. How do you know if you can trust the person by watching them on TV? What are they possibly doing? Well, it could be their voice. Their voice and their ability to empathize. Women voted more for Obama than Romney. And one of the big factors, they said, was empathy. They thought Obama empathized better than Romney. Romney couldn't connect with them when it came to empathy. And that was fascinating, because that's why they chose him. Now, a general election and a primary are totally different. General election, 9 out of 10 times, people are just going to pick based on their ideology. So if you're a Republican, you're going to go with a Republican. If you're a Democrat, you're going with a Democrat. Another fascinating study showed that most of us will be the same party affiliated that our parents have, that our parents are affiliated with. That's probably better said. But here's the other caveat. On the primaries, things do change because obviously you have candidates in the primary. They're in the same party. So how do we choose there if party affiliation is the number one pick in the general? Well, it changes. It goes back to those unconscious influences. It's going to be height. Whether you trust the candidate, whether they seem confident, whether they seem empathetic, especially for the females. That's one of the qualities they were looking for. And here's one more tidbit before we take our little brief break. One more tidbit I was doing some research on, and we're going to expand on this in future episodes, is called attachment theory out there. And one of the qualities children look for in their parents is availability and security. So think about this for a second. When you're a child, you're looking for your parent to be available. You're looking for your parent to provide security. Is that something we look for in our candidates? I think we do. We like a candidate, we'll say Trump for now, who's accessible, who's always on TV, always doing interviews. Many of the reporters find that very engaging. Of course, they like the ratings. But it's also, he's available. He's there, right? When mom and dad are there, the child is much happier when they're available. Same thing with security. We like to feel protected, somebody who's going to protect us. And in times like these, with terrorist groups out there, we may be looking for a candidate that can protect us. So the question I have for you is, which of these candidates do you feel is more available for you and makes you feel more secure? So we'll expand more on those unconscious influences in future episodes. For right now, we'll be right back after this break. We're minutes away from Emma Hernan, the model, coming up soon.
Hi, welcome to Adelante. This is Adelante Recovery, and my name is Yvette Kuglin, and I'm part of the staff.
Adelante Recovery Center has helped people in dual diagnosis for 5 years. We accept most PPO insurances and provide luxury accommodations and 24-hour support. To speak with an admissions counselor, call 1-888-242-4450.
A lot of time, we don't even know what's wrong with us, and sometimes we need to get away to figure that out. So if you want to go for a little retreat out in Corona Del Mar, which is a confidential location, we're here to help. So we're only a phone call away. Thank you.
Libyan visa. Official.
Pull over for inspection.
Sorry, sir, I can't do that.
Pull over for inspection!
How willing are you to die for your country? I'm ready to go right here, right now.
Everybody, this is Jack Silva.
Jack.
We trained SEALs at Coronado, so he knows the drill.
Welcome to Club Med.
We need immediate assistance. We are overrun.
States under attack. Let's go, man. States under attack.
Let's go. We gotta move.
If you do not get here soon, we're all gonna die.
You have a U.S. ambassador at risk.
The ambassador is in his safe haven. You're not the first responders. You're the last resort. You will wait.
None of you have to go. We are the only help they have.
Giving orders anymore. You're in my world now.
We have 36 American lives to save.
Welcome back, everyone. If you haven't seen 13 Hours yet, I'm telling you, it's a fascinating movie, a great book as well. I do both, watch the movie and read the book. So we're trying to make this a trend. We're trying to figure out what every day stands for, right? Today is a very strange one. It's National Big Block of Cheese Day. I know, you're asking me, what is Big Block of Cheese Day? Well, take a look at this.
Please stop calling.
Hey, it's me.
Okay, good. I thought it was Molina again. He won't stop calling and asking for Jay Carney.
Why won't he return my calls? Thought we were friends.
Oh, no.
We called because we wanted to talk to you about Big Block of Cheese Day.
Second annual. Mary, you on?
Cheese me.
Who's that?
Mary McCormick. National Security Advisor.
Well, you played one on TV.
Shall we start?
Good idea.
What is happening here?
Is this making you blue? Because blue is also a type of cheese.
Guys, I'm really busy.
Look, Josh, back in the day, Andrew Jackson trucked in a 2-ton block of cheese and put it in the foyer of the White House.
Yeah, I don't think they had trucks. It was a big event, so the president could talk to citizens about what was on their minds.
I know this. I watched The West Wing. Plus, we did this last year.
We think the White House should have a Big Block of Cheese Day, but on the internet.
BYOC, bring your own cheese.
I'm on board. We did this last year.
We want it to be feta than last year.
Is that Jenny?
You feta believe it.
We're already doing the second annual Big Block of Cheese Day. We'll have senior White House officials online answering questions from anybody that wants to ask.
So, like, Reddit?
Yeah, but without the weird stuff.
Hit me with the hashtag. What's the hashtag gonna be?
We're using Ask the WH. Who asked that? Mr. Sheen?
You better believe it. All right, I know Allison already used feta, but Limburger doesn't appeal to me. Hello?
Are you wondering why it's Big Block of Cheese Day? So am I. I don't think that video cleared it up much, but I know it's something that the White House started, and that's all I can say. In a few minutes, we're going to have Emma Hernan on. Now, we might have a little bit of an issue. She's having some trouble with her photo shoot, so hopefully we'll get her on at 12:40, maybe a little delayed, but we're going to find out. We'll show you a little video clip of her coming up in a few minutes as well. But before we get to that, the questions we're going to be talking with Emma, which I want you to call in or tweet us at TC Live News. You can also call us at 949-242-9720. Give us your questions. Share with us your thoughts about what you want us to ask her, because we're going to ask her, how is it to be a model? We're going to find out first about her a little bit, and then the world of modeling. See, it's going to be kind of tricky, doesn't it? You're going to have to be there in front of the camera all the time, having people look at you. You're going to have to look perfect all the time. You're going to have to behave a certain way. Hey, wait a minute. Don't I have to do that? Anyway, when you look that good, your looks are very important. So we're going to find out how she handles all that. She's a wonderful, beautiful woman, so we're going to figure that out when we talk to her in a little bit. So make sure, like I said before, send us your questions so we can find out what you want to know about how it is to be a model. Here's a little brief rundown, too, of what's coming up later today. We're going to be talking to Professor Tiamano right around 1 o'clock Pacific time, talking about Takfir. And at 1:30, we're going to be talking about drinkable books. Yeah, I know, sounds funny. But could you tear out a page of a book and use it as a water filter? Seems like you can. So we're going to learn more about that at 1:30 Pacific time. And we got some great shows coming up the rest of the week as well. Thursday, tomorrow, we're going to be talking about Sharia law. And is it compatible with American values? We're also going to have the most photographed fitness model in history, Dana Barberham. She'll be here tomorrow. Dana Barberham will be here tomorrow at 1:30 p.m. Pacific time. We have some great guests coming up the rest of this week, and stay tuned for next week. We have some fabulous, fabulous guests and shows coming up as well. We're going to be talking about politics, economics. We're going to be talking about food. We're going to be talking about all sorts of fun things, as well as psychology. So stay tuned. You're going to catch a little clip here in a little bit of Emma Hernan. We'll be back in a minute. Everybody, did you enjoy that video clip? I sure did. That's Emma Hernan, international model. And you know what? She's on the phone. So let's welcome Emma Hernan to Therapy Keep Alive. Welcome, Emma.
Hi, how are you?
Fantastic. How are you?
I'm great. I'm doing great right now.
Excellent. Thank you so much again for being on the show. Let me ask you a couple questions.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. So where are you from, Emma?
I'm from Boston originally, actually. actually a little small town called Scituate, which is the most Irish town in America. And I grew up there and then moved to LA about 2 years ago.
Oh, fabulous. Now, are you Irish then?
I am a little bit Irish.
Excellent. Do you have any siblings at all?
I do. I have an older brother. He's 2 years older than me, and he lives here in Boston, yeah.
That's going to cause me to ask a question here. So an older brother, is he overprotective of you?
He just started to be a little bit more protective of me. It's funny because he wasn't super protective of me. Growing up, I always had a boyfriend who was older than him, so he didn't have much to worry about. That was his job at that point. But now, he kind of took over the role, especially when I come home or if I go out with him anymore. He's very protective of me now.
Oh, really? That is funny.
Yeah, it's funny. He got more protective as I got older, I guess.
I have to ask, is your dad as well?
Yeah, same thing with my dad. I feel like my dad is a lot more protective of me now. Than he ever was. He's always been super protective of me, but even more so now, which is so funny.
That is funny. Well, I guess it's a good thing, right? That shows they love you.
Yeah, exactly. No, it's a great thing. Yeah, the two of them, I've got plenty of security, that's for sure.
Absolutely. What we're going to do is we're going to talk a couple more minutes. We're going to find out, and then we're going to take a break, and we're going to delve into a little bit into Emma Hernan's mind and take some calls and questions as well. But Emma, we're going to talk a little bit more. How did you get into the modeling business?
So I was out at lunch in Boston with my parents and my cousins, and there was a model scout there who they were actually doing like a little, it was a kids fashion show. One of the girls didn't make it, and they asked me if I wanted to do it, and then I actually signed with an agency that next week. So that's how it all started, really. It was just a scout we were at brunch with my family.
Oh, wow. A brunch?
Yeah, a brunch at a hotel in Boston, and the rest is history.
And they just picked you up? That's amazing.
Yeah, it was a cool story, and it was like a little small company that I did my first little fashion show for. It was called Oi Lily, and that's how it happened.
Well, you know what? I have no doubt about it. When we looked at the pictures here and the comments we've gotten, I'm not surprised at all. Surprised you weren't snatched up a little earlier than that. Well, we're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to come right back and get into the mind of Emma Hernan. So stay tuned.
Hi. Welcome to Adelante. This is Adelante Recovery, and my name is Yvette Kuglin, and I'm part of the staff.
Adelante Recovery Center has helped people in dual diagnosis for 5 years. We accept most PPO insurances and provide luxury accommodations and 24-hour support. To speak with an admissions counselor, call 1-888-242-4450.
A lot of time, we don't even know what's wrong with us, and sometimes we need to get away to figure that out. So if you want to go for a little retreat out in Corona Del Mar, which is a confidential location, we're here to help. So we're only a phone call away. Thank you.
iTalk is a new show dedicated to breaking the stigmas attached to taboo topics that are considered uncomfortable.
In hopes to educate and spread awareness, comfortability, and understanding.
So let's get uncomfortable!
Welcome back, everyone. So Emma Hernan is still on the line, international model. So let's ask Emma right now, first question, psychological question, I say. We're going to probe the mind here. So Emma, you take a lot of pictures all the time, and a lot of people always wonder, is that tiring?
It actually is. You wouldn't think, like, I know people would be like, oh, it's so easy. You sit there, you get paid to take pictures, and you think it was so easy. But when you're holding a pose, or there's lights constantly being flashed in your face, or you have an outfit on that you can't sit down because you can't cause a wrinkle on the outfit.
Oh, wow.
It is so tiring. Yeah, I've fainted a few times on set. It's easier. It looks easier than it is. It's hard.
You fainted a couple times on set?
Yeah.
Oh,
no,
wow.
I fainted, especially from the lights. You can't eat anything when you have the outfits on sometimes, because God forbid you get like a stain on something, and you can't sit either because you can't wrinkle them. You're standing there in high heels with bright lights on you. Yeah, I fainted not once or twice, but I fainted at least like 3 or 4 times because I've been doing it for so long.
I'm watching right now the video of you, and I'm seeing you standing there. Yeah, I can just picture that. It looks kind of, because you have to stand there for quite a bit of time, right, for them to get the right shot.
Yeah, exactly. And then you have to redo the same, like if you're doing like a hair flip or if you're twirling, you have to redo it like 20 times to get the shot that they're looking for. So definitely a lot goes into that one picture that like people see.
Oh, man. So
yeah.
Now, is it hard to always be there to flip your hair all the time and keep the face and the emotion going?
Oh, yeah, because you're flipping your hair and you're trying to think about flipping your hair, but then you also have to remember you can't be making a weird face. So it's kind of like it's a hard thing to pick up at first, because at first I was like flipping my hair and my face would be like doing God knows what. But now I kind of have the hang of it where I need to make sure my face is on and my hair.
Oh, that's true. I didn't think about that. The timing makes a big difference.
Exactly. Oh, yeah, like night and day.
If you're flipping your hair and you're making a goofy face, not that attractive.
Exactly. Yeah, no, it's definitely not the picture that they're looking for.
No, I guess not. And what was your favorite place that you took pictures at? Any shoot that you really enjoyed? Was it a certain country or place?
I would probably have to say Hawaii. I did a bikini shoot down in Hawaii, and it was just gorgeous. The water, everything, the whole location, and it was relaxing. It was a very relaxing shoot, and it was in Hawaii, which is obviously beautiful, but that was probably my favorite shoot that I did do.
Let me take a break here for a second. I'm going to grab a caller. We actually have Nina from Irvine, I think it is, or is it Irvine? It's in California is all I know. She's going to call right now. I'm going to take her call really quickly. Is that all right?
Yeah.
All right, let's see what Nina has to say. Hi, Nina. This is Dr. Carlos and Emma. Oh, hold on, we got to put her on speaker. There you go. Go ahead.
Yeah, Emma, before I go on, I just want to let you know you're really pretty.
Oh, thank you so much. That's so sweet.
You're welcome. I have a question for you, actually. Since you're really busy, like, modeling and traveling around, like, how do you juggle, modeling and romantic relationships?
Oh, that's a good one.
For me, I think it was, I was in an 8-year relationship, which ended kind of when I came to California and started to become busier, because it was hard to have a steady relationship while I was traveling and working so much. So now it's just, I'm not seeing anyone specific right now. It's easier to talk to a few people, and it's definitely harder dating when you're so busy. But I try to make it work, and I'll be in LA for a while, so then that's when I'll try to, like, meet somebody. But I've learned that it's better to just happen naturally anyways.
You know what's funny? The minute you said you weren't dating anybody, we got about 150 calls. I don't know what happened there, but our lines are just jumping off here. I'm sorry, Nina. What were you saying, Nina?
Yeah, I have another question for you, Emma.
Oh, another one.
You're going to be in LA for a while. Is it hard to meet guys in LA or date them and meet them?
Definitely LA. I would say it's weird because there's definitely more opportunities to meet guys and go on like a date or two. But to have a genuine relationship in LA, I will say, is a lot harder than anywhere else. So it's kind of a weird like thing about LA.
That's a little different. Thank you so much, Nina, for calling in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, that was great questions there from Nina and Nina in California. Excellent stuff.
Yeah.
And actually, I'm going to expand a little bit on that. When you date out here, when you date in Boston or wherever you're dating, do you get solicited a lot by wealthy men?
Because my name's kind of growing and out there, that
yeah.
Definitely I feel like more men of higher status, or whether it's an athlete or a celebrity or this or that, you know, there's so many more ways between an agent or through social media for them to reach out now. So I've definitely noticed that as I've become like a little bit more well known.
Does that make a difference to you, or do you care?
For me, it doesn't, only because I've been super successful on my own. I, you know, I've modeled, but I also I went to business school for a little bit, and I've invested all of my modeling money, and I've done extremely well in like the stock market and everything. So
good for you.
It's just surprising. Like, yeah, I'm definitely like a little businesswoman at heart. I help run my family's company too. So for me, I don't need that, just because I have my own thing going, and I'd rather have something genuine than something that's superficial.
Absolutely. Beauty and brains. Emma Hernan, everyone. International model. Let me ask you this question. We're going to go probing back in the mind of Emma here for a minute. So we were talking earlier about how tiring and difficult it can be modeling. A lot of people think, oh, she's just standing in front of the camera, taking a picture and moving on. But it's actually a lot more time consuming and a lot more difficult. Did you find it challenging in the sense when you started going more into the bikini shots? Was that more challenging for you? Was that more, how would you say, difficult?
Like, you know, you walk in and you're changing in front of a whole group of people, whether it's stylists, hair and makeup and everything like that. But at first, of course, like, you know what I mean? When I'm in high school you're still in your awkward phase a little bit, and you're changing in front of, like, you know, guy photographers and stuff like that, you tend to turn the other way. But now I'm at the point where I'm just so used to it, so I'm super comfortable. But at first, it definitely was a little bit difficult. I would say that.
Yeah, I would imagine. And what's your favorite type of shoot? Is it better when you're all dressed up? Because you have a really lovely shoot. I think you were in a long dress. Your hair was out long and not put up. That was beautiful. And then you also have had others in swimsuits. Anything you prefer better? Swimsuits, long dresses, anything like that?
I think they're both really different. I enjoy them both. Just because when it comes to dresses, you're super glammed up and, you know, you're walking around and definitely, like, a lot of attention's on you. But when it comes to, like, bikini, it's a little bit more natural. There's not as much makeup on. You're on the beach. And, like, I grew up, and the town that I'm from is a beach town, so.
Oh, okay.
And I was also a swimmer. I placed second nationally in backstroke. So, jeez. I love the water. So I would probably say I prefer the bikini shoots a little bit.
That's amazing. Okay, so you got brains, beauty, and an athlete. Now we got 400 callers waiting online. We did get a tweet from somebody, Jackie from Ontario, California. She wants to know, do you have to watch what you eat every time or before you go out to a photo shoot?
I have like my favorite things. Like, I love Cheez-Its. I'm never going to stop eating those. But I definitely try to be like a little bit healthier with like my juices and stuff like that. I have like fresh juice every day, but I'm not a type of person, I'm not going to sit there and starve myself, because I just think crash diets they don't work in the long run. So for me, I try to just work out, and, you know, I can have what I want to have.
How often do you work out?
I try to work out at least 5 times a week, but I'm always active. I have like dogs back home, so I'm going for hikes with them, you know what I mean? Whether it's either I'm in the gym 5 days a week, or if I'm just, you know, going for a hike or going for a swim or surfing or skiing or doing something along those lines.
I know you were busy earlier, but we did show a video earlier. Today is the National Day for Big Block of Cheese Day, just in case. The White House announced that a couple years ago.
Oh, wow.
So there you go. Timing is everything, isn't it?
And exactly. Perfect.
Do you have anything coming up in the future that you can share with us? Where is Emma going to be?
Photographers, his Instagram is Dream State Live, but he's just amazing, and there's like a big company that's taking us out there to shoot that. But also Stella Official, which they're a dress company. I shot with them a few times before, but we're working on like a big campaign right now, so that would be exciting.
And I know she told me off camera she had some other surprises that she can't share with us. So I highly advise that you follow Emma Hernan. Where can we follow you, Emma?
Definitely on Instagram for sure. Twitter, which is just Emma Hernan, or Twitter, which is Emma L. Hernan, because my middle name is Lee. So either place right there works for me.
So we can find you on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, I think, too, correct?
Yeah, no, I have a Facebook as well. Yep, Emma Hernan.
Excellent. So, Emma Hernan, thank you so much again for being on the show. I truly appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
It's been so much fun, everybody. I hope you had as much fun as I did. Emma Hernan, that's H-E-R-N-A-N. Look for her on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook. Beauty, brains, wow, and an athlete. Unbelievable. We'll be back right after these messages.
Hi, welcome to Adelante. This is Adelante Recovery, and my name is Yvette Kuglin, and I'm part of the staff.
Adelante Recovery Center has helped people in dual diagnosis for 5 years. We accept most PPO insurances and provide luxury accommodations and 24-hour support. To speak with an admissions counselor, call 1-888-242-4450.
A lot of time, we don't even know what's wrong with us, and sometimes we need to get away to figure that out. So if you want to go for a little retreat out in Corona Del Mar, which is a confidential location, we're here to help. So we're only a phone call away. Thank you.
Light Talk is a new show dedicated to breaking the stigmas attached to taboo topics that are considered uncomfortable.
In hopes to educate and spread awareness, comfortability, and understanding.
So let's get uncomfortable!
Back in a little bit with Dr. Timani. He's going to be talking about Takfir. You ever heard of that? Well, it's when Muslims declare other Muslims as infidels, right? We hear that all the time in the news when you have these radical Islamists saying attacking the other infidels, whether it's Christians or whoever doesn't believe in their radical Islam. But what happens? Do they attack their own Muslims? Well, a lot, unfortunately. They do attack Muslims if they don't believe in the same law. So we're going to find out more about that with Professor Timani later on. Right after this commercial, you're going to check out 13 Hours. Great movie. Take a look.
Libyan visa. Official.
Pull over for inspection.
Sorry, sir, I can't do that.
Pull over for inspection!
How willing are you to die for your country? I'm ready to go right here, right now.
Everybody, this is Jack Silva.
Jack.
We trained SEALs at Coronado, so he knows the drill.
Welcome to Club Med.
We need immediate assistance. We are overrun.
State's under attack.
Let's go, man. State's under attack.
Let's go. We gotta move.
If you do not get here soon, we're all gonna die.
You have a U.S. ambassador at risk.
The ambassador is in his safe haven. You're not the first responders. You're the last resort. You will wait.
None of you have to go. But we are the only help they have.
Giving orders anymore. You're in my world now.
We have 36 American lives to save.
back, everyone. Now we're going to be with Dr. Hussam Timani. He is associate professor at the Department of Philosophy and Religious Studies, and he did some fascinating research I want to talk about. So let's welcome to the show Dr. Timani. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
So Dr. Timani, how did you get started in this research? Actually, you know what? Why don't you define the word takfir for us, and then you can tell us how you got started in the research for this.
Okay, the term takfir is Arabic for the act of one Muslim declaring another Muslim infidel. Which means the excommunication of believers from the community. So this is the term takfir. And when we say kafir, which means we are describing someone who was stripped from his or her beliefs. So kafir is the infidel, takfir is the action when you take this action to declare someone else as infidel.
Fascinating. And what got you started looking into this?
Well, I've been studying extremist movements in the Muslim world for the last 10 years, and I published my first book on the first Islamic movement in the 7th century to adopt this ideology. So that's how it started, and I get interested in movements that they adopt this ideology. And what got me interested in doing this research lately is the rise of the takfirist movements, which means movements in the Muslim world today, especially in the Middle East, that they declared other Muslims infidel, like Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and other splinter groups, that they have been practicing this this ideology lately. So I thought my research is to track the beginning, the roots of this theology or ideology, and this is my research that I started exploring how this theology emerged. And my research is limited only to classical and medieval Islam. So future research will explore this term and this ideology in contemporary Muslim movements.
Now, let me see if I can get some clarity just to make sure I'm not off track. So, for instance, the Sunni and Shia divide, is that an example of takfir? Do they consider each other as infidels?
That's right. Well, if we want to look, usually this term is more popular among the Sunni.
Okay.
Sunni sect. It doesn't mean that some Shias do not use it, but extreme Sunnis like ISIS, they declared Shias as infidels, which means they were Muslims and they are no longer Muslims. So which means Shias are infidels, they are automatically infidels. Now you have that ISIS, they declare some Sunnis as kuffar or kafir if they disagree with their theology. So now ISIS will assess the beliefs of their fellow Sunnis. But now Shias, they are automatically declared infidel or kafir, which means, infidels. That's the Arabic they use for that.
And is there a direct correlation between the takfir ideology and is there a correlation with violence there? Or is it just an ostracization of them? Do they just ostracize the other group? Or do they actually take some kind of...
That's right. So you have some interpretations. Now, it is interpretations. It's not something that in the Islamic teachings or theology. It is interpretation that if a Muslim is declared infidel or kafir, that person must be killed, eliminated.
Killed or eliminated?
That's the interpretation, and that's the modern Muslim movements, extremists, they believe that this is the right interpretation, and they believe that this is what they should do when they declare another Muslim infidel. And we saw that in the assassination of Anwar Sadat in 1981,
that's right.
The president of Egypt, and the Muslim extremist group declared him infidel, kafir, before they assassinate him.
Well, that's right. It's a good point.
Yes, it is linked to killing and violence.
Now, we like to be balanced on the show. So normal contemporary Muslims or Islamic religion does not believe this. Is that correct?
No. The majority of Muslims, mainstream Islam or modern Muslims, do not believe that a kafir, someone who is declared infidel, should be killed. No. So it is only interpretations used by extremists. You have some cases where Islamic courts, whether in Pakistan, in Egypt, where they convicted some Muslims of being infidel because they committed blasphemy according to the Islamic court. Now, these people were not killed, of course, but they were declared non-Muslims. And that's it. So that's the, again, in modern times, that's how the concept was used to that extent. But extremist groups, they take it to a new level, to a higher level, by saying, well, a person who is declared a kafir should be killed.
That's a good thing. We want to make sure everybody understands that out there. They don't believe in the same thing as the extremists. And the other part, too, I guess I wanted to ask you is, I don't know if you did the research on this or you're familiar with it, the modern day Muslim or Islam, when they see an infidel or they meet somebody, I guess, who fits that type, what is usually the thought process? Is it something, oh, they just don't believe in Muhammad, I feel bad for them, and move on? Or do they want to convert them? Do they have a kind of like a game plan with that?
Okay, you mean for non-Muslims with the extremist movements today?
No, the non-extremists.
Okay.
If they meet somebody...
Huh? Yeah, can you repeat that question? I didn't get to your question, actually.
Yeah, if a modern-day Muslim or Islamist today meets somebody who's, I guess, an infidel, somebody who doesn't believe in the Muslim religion, what do they think of that person? Do they think anything at all? Do they think, oh, I feel bad for them because they're not a Muslim?
I mean, again, this is it depends on the person. It depends on the country. So, again, Islam is not monolithic, so you have Muslims who are very open-minded, who would accept anyone, whether they are atheists or they are Hindus or Buddhists or not, again, whatever they want to believe.
Okay.
They believe that, well, it is in the Quran that people are free to worship any deity they want. Jews and Christians, they are believers. And even you have in the Quran that other people, they are called believers, although they don't believe in God. So for modern Muslim and mainstream Muslim, that if you don't believe in God, it's your... this is your opinion. Now, you have some people saying, well, we invite you to the Quran, we invite you to read in the Quran and to be a believer, it's better for you. But usually, and that's how it happened throughout the Islamic history, where Muslims conquered foreign nations where they had no belief, and the Muslims at that time invited them for Islam. If they didn't accept, they left them alone. So that's what you see in the Islamic teaching. Now, when I talk about the Muslim movement, the extremists declaring someone kafir and killing him, it's their own interpretation. So they look for materials that would help them provide this kind of interpretation, which the majority of Muslims disagree with this interpretation.
Got it. Perfect. That's what I wanted to make sure, so people understood that.
Yeah.
And we're going to go back to Takfir in a couple of minutes. But before we go to commercial break, have you done any research at all in regards to the ISIL group, the ISIS group, or Al-Qaeda?
Well, I've been following their ideologies, and that's right. I have done some research about their ideology, and where they trace their, or how they support their views using some Islamic interpretation, some Islamic text to support their views. So I've done some research about that.
Well, hang on to that thought, because we're going to talk about that right after this commercial break. We're going to find out how they support their views. So hang tight, people.
Welcome to Adelante. This is Adelante Recovery, and my name is Yvette Kuglin, and I'm part of the staff.
Adelante Recovery Center has helped people in dual diagnosis for 5 years. We accept most PPO insurances and provide luxury accommodations and 24-hour support. To speak with an admissions counselor, call 1-888-242-4450.
A lot of time, we don't even know what's wrong with us, and sometimes we need to get away to figure that out. So if you want to go for a little retreat out in Corona Del Mar, which is a confidential location, we're here to help. So we're only a phone call away. Thank you.
Light Talk is a new show dedicated to breaking the stigmas attached to taboo topics that are considered uncomfortable.
In hopes to educate and spread awareness, comfortability, and understanding.
So let's get uncomfortable!
$3.4 million people die each year from water-related disease. But the even bigger problem? Most of them don't even know their water is unsafe to drink in the first place. That's why WaterisLife, partnering with scientists and engineers at Carnegie Mellon and the University of Virginia, set out to invent a solution that solves both of these problems. Introducing the Drinkable Book, the first ever tool that teaches safe water habits and is printed on technologically advanced filter paper capable of killing deadly waterborne diseases.
My name is Terry Dinkvich. I am a chemist. I invented a paper that purifies drinking water. After passing water through our filter, we found a reduction of greater than 99.9% in bacteria count, which is comparable to the tap water in this country.
The book uses a brand new type of paper that works like a scientific coffee filter. Each piece is coated with silver nanoparticles, which kill diseases like cholera, E. coli, and typhoid.
The orange color of the paper is a direct result of the addition of the silver nanoparticles. And at the end of the day, the most important thing, and really the hero of this whole project, is the technology behind it.
The book itself works in three easy steps. Simply tear out a filter, slide it into the custom filter box, and pour contaminated water through. What comes out is safe to drink. The content on each page, printed in food-grade ink, educates people about safe water habits, things that we take for granted, such as keeping trash and feces away from your water source. But the best part of the book isn't just that it purifies water or teaches proper sanitation. It's the fact that this filter paper will revolutionize water purification. It costs only pennies to produce, making it by far the cheapest option on the market, and it's extremely sustainable. Each filter is capable of giving someone up to 30 days worth of clean water, and each book is capable of providing someone with clean water for up to 4 years. To learn how you can provide a filter book for a community in need, head to waterislife.com.
Welcome back, everyone. We're going to continue our conversation on Takfir, a very complicated subject, but we have a guy who can simple it all out for us, Dr. Tamani. Welcome back, Dr. Tamani.
Thank you.
So I know we talked a little bit before during the commercial break that you were going to help us separate or show us the differences between ISIL and Al-Qaeda.
Yes. Well, Al-Qaeda was more interested in spreading their ideology overseas, going toward, again, their interest is outside the Muslim world. They believe that their ideology, their interpretation of Islam, should be dominant all over the world. So that their enemy really was, their enemies were the non-Muslims who were, whether it's in Europe, in the United States, they were not interested in making other Muslims the enemies. They were not really practicing takfir against other Muslims within the Muslim world, except for here and there where they believe that some Muslims, like the Saudi royal family, that they are not really good Muslims. All right, so now we see that Al-Qaeda is more international and its action toward non-Muslims. Now, ISIL split from Al-Qaeda, and why? Because they focused on the Muslims in the Middle East. So what happened is that ISIL established the Islamic Caliphate, what they call Islamic Caliphate, and their interest is to purify Islam. So Al-Qaeda was not interested in purifying Islam. Now ISIL was interested in purifying Islam, which means they have to assess the beliefs of people, of the Sunnis. So now they make sure that the Sunnis who live among them, they adhere to their ideology. Muslims who are not Sunnis, like Shiites and others, they declare them kuffar, infidels. And we have seen how they did with Shiites and with groups who are not Muslims. So now ISIL is not really international. It is its goal is to establish an Islamic state and to purify Islam and to eliminate Muslims who either they do not adhere to the Sunni tradition, or if they are Sunnis, they want to make sure that they adhere to their own interpretation of Islam. And we see how ISIL is expanding only in Middle Eastern countries. Now, we hear about attacks that lately happened in Europe and the United States. These are attacks, they are ISIS-inspired, but they were not really called by ISIS to launch these attacks in the West. So that's how we see that ISIL is really adopting this idea of Takfir in a way to purify Islam and to call the good, the true Muslims, as they call them, to come and live in the Islamic State. So that's how Al-Qaeda is different from ISIL.
That's fascinating. There is a distinction there. Let me ask you this question. Is there any reward for attacking the kuffars? The extremist groups, of course.
Interpretation. Yes, it's they think it's a duty. Again, reward, maybe it's not, but it's a duty. And then if it is a religious duty, then there must be some reward. So again, true. They believe that it's a duty to eliminate the kuffar because they are too dangerous, because they pose a threat to Islam. And according to their interpretation, if you tolerate a kafir, which means you are contributing to damaging Islam. You are contributing or you are supporting harming Islam. So they believe that it's your duty to eliminate the kuffar because they are a threat to Islam. And even you have, they can dig and find some literature saying that if a Muslim who remains quiet when he is in the presence of a kafir, which means he is a kafir too.
Oh, and wow.
Again, so this again is interpretation, which means if, encountering a kafir who is a threat to Islam, then this kafir must be eliminated for Islam to remain pure.
So basically, inaction is action.
That's right. Action, which means you are supporting, really, the infidels. You are supporting this idea that Islam or those who are trying to harm Islam or things like that. So, yes, inaction is really action.
That's interesting. I know yesterday on the show I was talking to people about what we call a logical fallacy. It's called a Hobson choice, where they only give you two choices, either you're for or against us. There's no in between, and that seems like they're using that tactic as well.
In my research, I found that if you go back in time, when Islam was a great civilization, really Muslims did not practice takfir. It was just a term that they used and they studied. But what happened is, what I found is that when Islam started to decline, when there was a decline in the Islamic civilization, then the rise of Takfirist movement emerged. And the more you have Islam in decline, the more some extremists are going to adopt this idea. So this is what happens, that I make a link between decline of Islam and the rise of Takfirist. So Takfirists believe that by declaring other kuffar and eliminating them, they are trying to preserve Islam. So when Islam was in at its height, at its peak, people did not need to practice Takfir because it was, again, Islam was fine. So that's what I see, is that the more Islam in decline, the more you have those problems, Muslims going backward, no economy, no jobs, no intellectual advancements. I want to see more Takfirists emerging, just believing that, well, this is the answer to all these problems.
That's why you're the expert, because you actually jumped ahead. That was my next question, is what motivates a lot of these Takfirists? And you were saying the socioeconomic environment does, correct?
That's right. That's the question that further research is required to see what motivates people to, and more movements to become more into this idea to declare the order infidel. So, and this is my theory.
I know we have about 1 or 2 minutes left, and did you see any correlations, or have you found any or researched it yet in regards to education levels?
Well, that's right. So there is discourse today. You have leaders, Muslim scholars, theologians in the Middle East, and talking about Muslim leaders, Muslim theologians, they are calling for reforming the education system about Islam. So, for example, the president of Egypt, Sisi, he said, well, there must be a revolution in terms of the changing the way people are educated about Islam. So there is somewhere something wrong that is happening in terms of how people are educated about Islam. So now, this is for the first time, is that people are saying, well, let's look what is being taught in these schools, and there must we have to do something about reforming, which means better education that is suitable for the modern world, for the 21st century, where it's globalization, where people are interacting with each other. So education is key to definitely defeat this ideology.
Absolutely. Dr. Tamani.
It has to come from the Muslims, definitely.
Oh, it has to come from the Muslims themselves.
That's right.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Dr. Tamani, again, for being here. We truly appreciate it.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you so much for the work you're doing. We will talk to you soon. Is there anywhere we can go to find more information about you?
Well, I have a website on my school at Christopher Newport University. And I can't think of other, again, Google.
Google, there you go.
You can Google me.
The cheapest business card around. Thank you again, Dr. Tamani. We truly appreciate your time.
I hope I answered all your questions. So.
Oh, you did. But you caused about 100 more, but you did answer all my questions.
Okay, great.
Thank you so much.
Take care.
Bye-bye now. Thank you, everyone. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. That was a very fascinating conversation. About Takfir. I would Google it if I was you and look up Dr. Tamani and learn more about it. And if you're really a go-getter, you can read the research he did on it. Well, what happens if your country or city has too much pollution? Can it be turned into a fashion statement? Well, we're going to find out a little later on in the hour after our next guest. But our next guest has a really fascinating story as well. Can you drink a book? Kind of. We're going to show you. Take a look at this ad. And we'll contact our next guest in a little bit. See you in a bit.
3.4 million people die each year from water-related disease. But the even bigger problem? Most of them don't even know their water is unsafe to drink in the first place. That's why WaterisLife, partnering with scientists and engineers at Carnegie Mellon and the University of Virginia, set out to invent a solution that solves both of these problems. Introducing the Drinkable Book, the first ever tool that teaches safe water habits and is printed on technologically advanced filter paper capable of killing deadly waterborne diseases.
My name is Terry Dinkvich. I am a chemist. I invented a paper that purifies drinking water. After passing water through our filter, we found a reduction of greater than 99.9% in bacteria count, which is comparable to the tap water in this country.
The book uses a brand new type of paper that works like a scientific coffee filter. Each piece is coated with silver nanoparticles, which kill diseases like cholera, E. coli, and typhoid.
The orange color of the paper is a direct result of the addition of the silver nanoparticles. And at the end of the day, the most important thing, and really the hero of this whole project, is the technology behind it.
The book itself works in three easy steps. Simply tear out a filter, slide it into the custom filter box, and pour contaminated water through. What comes out is safe to drink. The content on each page, printed in food-grade ink, educates people about safe water habits, things that we take for granted, such as keeping trash and feces away from your water source. But the best part of the book isn't just that it purifies water or teaches proper sanitation, it's the fact that this filter paper will revolutionize water purification. It costs only pennies to produce, making it by far the cheapest option on the market, and it's extremely sustainable. Each filter is capable of giving someone up to 30 days worth of clean water, and each book is capable of providing someone with clean water for up to 4 years. To learn how you can provide a filter book for a community in need, head to waterislife.com. 3.4 million people die each year from water-related disease, but the even bigger problem? Most of them don't even know their water is unsafe to drink in the first place. That's why WaterisLife, partnering with scientists and engineers at Carnegie Mellon and the University of Virginia, set out to invent a solution that solves both of these problems. Introducing the Drinkable Book, the first ever tool that teaches safe water habits and is printed on technologically advanced filter paper capable of killing deadly waterborne diseases.
My name is Terry Dinkvich. I am a chemist. I invented a paper that purifies drinking water. After passing water through our filter, we found a reduction of greater than 99.9% in bacteria count, which is comparable to the tap water in this country.
The book uses a brand new type of paper that works like a scientific coffee filter. Each piece is coated with silver nanoparticles, which kill diseases like cholera, E. coli, and typhoid.
The orange color of the paper is a direct result of the addition of the silver nanoparticles. And at the end of the day, the most important thing, and really the hero of this whole project, is the technology behind it.
The book itself works in three easy steps. Simply tear out a filter, slide it into the custom filter box, and pour contaminated water through. What comes out is safe to drink. The content on each page, printed in food-grade ink, educates people about safe water habits, things that we take for granted, such as keeping trash and feces away from your water source. But the best part of the book isn't just that it purifies water or teaches proper sanitation, it's the fact that this filter paper will revolutionize water purification. It costs only pennies to produce, making it by far the cheapest option on the market, and it's extremely sustainable. Each filter is capable of giving someone up to 30 days worth of clean water, and each book is capable of providing someone with clean water for up to 4 years. To learn how you can provide a filter book for a community in need, head to waterislife.com.
An amazing commercial or what? Isn't that fascinating?
Yeah,
the Drinkable
did
Book?
A really good job with that, yeah.
Yep, that's the voice of Ken Surratt, the founder of waterislife.com. Ken, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here. Thank you, Dr. Carlos. Appreciate you having us on today.
No, this is a wonderful, wonderful idea, wonderful concept, and I had a lot of questions already sent to us throughout the week waiting for this show. So tell us a little bit how you got started on this project.
Wow.
We got 15 minutes, so yeah.
Yeah, okay. I'll give you the short version. Now, this is going to conjure up a really ugly mental picture, but the whole concept of Water's Life came to me standing naked in a shower in Nairobi.
Okay.
Yuck. Yeah, nasty mental picture for sure. But
depends who's standing there, but yeah, go ahead.
The backstory: I got back to Nairobi after spending a couple of weeks with some amazing people, the Turkana people up in northern Kenya and southern Sudan. Absolutely amazing experience. But I got back, I hadn't seen a shower in a couple of weeks, so I'm standing there warming up the shower. Yeah, of course, my pants, they're up off running by themselves at this point, but I'm watching watching the water go down the drain, and I mean, it hits me like a ton of bricks, Ken. Water is life here. People that you just left would give anything to have the water you're just letting go down the drain. And so I came back, started telling the story to some friends. One of my buddies is an internet guru, and he said, you got to buy that website. And I said, what are you talking about? And he says, water is life. And so we reached out to waterislife.org, which was our first choice, but no response. Called the guy that had waterislife.com. He says, yeah. He says, it's a great name. I want $2,000 for it. I said, man, I only have $200, but less $2,000. He said, I'll take $200. So wired him $200, and waterislife.com was born. Drilled my first water well back in 07, and we're in 40 different countries now around the world with water sanitation and hygiene projects.
That's fascinating. 40 countries already.
Yes, sir.
And how long was the project? I mean, how long has it been existing?
Since 2007, I drilled my first well. 2009, we got accepted as a 501c3 charitable organization by the IRS. It had already been doing a lot of work before then.
That's fabulous. Well, I know a lot of people are going to be wondering, what is this drinkable book?
Well, the drinkable book is a great concept, a great idea. We're working on the deployment process now to be able to put this in the hands of as many people as possible. It's a book that will treat water and kill the bacteria in it. Not really new technology. In fact, Dr. Carlos, it's old technology. Cowboys used to take a silver dollar, drop it into their canteens, fill up their canteen with water, shake it around, and silver would flake off of that silver dollar into the water, killing the bacteria and allowing them to, you know, not have giardia or beaver fever, as it's called, back in the wild, wild west days. So, I mean, it's not new technology, it's just a new application. What we're excited about is it's the opportunity to be able to teach water sanitation and hygiene in a fun way, but then also be able to provide treatment for the water that would be bacteria-free for the people that are using it. Our goal is to put these into the hands of students in schools, make it be part of the curriculum so that, you know, they're using the curriculum as a part of teaching the good sanitation, the hygiene habits, and how to care for their water as part of, you know, their ongoing curriculum for their schools. So pretty excited about it. It's a lot of fun. It's opened up a lot of great doors. I actually got invited last year to Frankfurt, Germany, to speak at the World Book Publishers Convention. There's 300,000 book publishers. All of them are pushing their stuff toward digital, and they had me do a keynote on why all innovation in publishing isn't necessarily digital. Because here I am standing there with a, you know, book and in hardback form. So it was pretty fun. It was a lot of fun. A lot of great questions.
Yeah. What do books look like anymore?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. I mean, and I'm the same way. I read everything on my, you know, on my iPad. You know, it's like I carry, you know, 10,000 books, and it's, you know, doesn't weigh but a few ounces.
Now, in the books, is there actual writing? I mean, these are books that are actually used?
Yeah, the pages, what we've got is like water sanitation and hygiene information in multiple languages. And so we'll have it like in English, and then we'll have it in, say, Hindi or Creole or Kiswahili. So that people can read in their own native language. And so as we expand more, as we add more to it, I picked up some kind of crud, and really affected my voice. But as we are able to deploy that in more and more countries, be able to put it in different languages.
That sounds fascinating. I know we have a very innovative idea from one of our viewers out there. They sent a tweet in a couple of days ago, and I'll give you that question.
Fantastic.
After the break, I thought it was a pretty neat idea. But in the books, they're more about how to purify water. So this is not really like a Shakespeare. You don't have a Macbeth book that's drinkable or anything like that.
No. It's you know, about how to care for your water, about clean habits, healthy habits that you can have. You know, washing your hands and things like that. Ways to keep your water clean. But, you know, basic sanitation and hygiene taught to the students so that they can then hopefully take that home and teach to their parents as well.
I know we did get one tweet the other day saying, do they have a Moby Dick version of the book?
But yeah, I don't. Well, you know, each one of these books lasts about 4 years.
4 years?
Yeah.
How many glasses can they filter? Or page?
Each half page, the way we've got it sectioned right now, each half page will do about a month's worth of water treatment.
A month's worth?
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that's fabulous.
Yeah.
And how many pages are in a book?
I haven't counted up. There's enough for 4 years' worth.
Oh, for 4 years' worth.
So what would that be?
48 pages.
48 pages, 48 sections.
That's fabulous. Now, does the cover have any special properties, too, or...?
No, it does not.
Okay. Just checking, maybe it was some kind of solar protection or something.
No.
That's something you work with the solar energy groups, right?
Exactly. We'll get some really smart guys from solar in on it and see if we can't solar power that thing.
And is it being used in any country currently?
Right now we're testing. We've got it tested in 6 countries. And so
okay.
as we continue to push forward, We're hopeful that we can do something here in the United States too. You know, kind of a Tom's buy one give one. Because of the novelty of it, it's really caught the attention of a lot of media and a lot of folks. And we really appreciate, you know, everybody that is following WaterisLife and helping to retweet videos and stuff like that. Man, we can't say thank you enough. You know, we live and die on social media. Really yeah. appreciate all the help that we can get from our friends on social media.
We thank you very much for being on the show. We're going to take a quick break now. We're going to show the people once again the ad about Water is Life, and we're going to come
fantastic.
Back right back and ask that question that I thought was a pretty neat idea. We'll be right back, everybody.
3.4 million people die each year from water-related disease, but the even bigger problem, most of them don't even know their water is unsafe to drink in the first place. That's why Water is Life, partnering with scientists and engineers at Carnegie Mellon and the University of Virginia, set out to invent a solution that solves both of these problems. Introducing the Drinkable Book, the first ever tool that teaches safe water habits and is printed on technologically advanced filter paper capable of killing deadly waterborne diseases.
My name is Terry Dinkvich. I am a chemist. I invented a paper that purifies drinking water. After passing water through our filter, we found a reduction of greater than 99.9% in bacteria count, which is comparable to the tap water in this country.
The book uses a brand new type of paper that works like a scientific coffee filter. Each piece is coated with silver nanoparticles, which kill diseases like cholera, E. coli, and typhoid.
The orange color of the paper is a direct result of the addition of the silver nanoparticles. And at the end of the day, the most important thing, and really the hero of this whole project, is the technology behind it.
The book itself works in 3 easy steps. Simply tear out a filter, slide it into the custom filter box, and pour contaminated water through. What comes out is safe to drink. The content on each page, printed in food-grade ink, educates people about safe water habits, things that we take for granted, such as keeping trash and feces away from your water source. But the best part of the book isn't just that it purifies water or teaches proper sanitation, it's the fact that this filter paper will revolutionize water purification. It costs only pennies to produce, making it by far the cheapest option on the market, and it's extremely sustainable. Each filter is capable of giving someone up to 30 days worth of clean water, and each book is capable of providing someone with clean water for up to 4 years. To learn how you can provide a filter book for a community in need, head to waterislife.com.
Talking with Ken Surrett, the CEO and founder of waterislife.com. You can find him there. Fascinating story. We're talking about the Drinkable Book. And now we had a question that I thought was pretty creative. So, Ken, here's the idea that our friend, I think, what was his name again? I'm going to look real quick here, so I give him his due here. It's Phil from Philadelphia. What he actually said was, can you make it in a magazine form like People or The Economist, where you can send them a magazine, they can look at it, read it, and then instead of tossing it away, they can actually just use it as water filters?
Absolutely. We actually had poster sizes of the paper at the UN, at the big conference in New York on water. So yeah, there's versatility in the size and the format of the printing.
Great.
love to, you know, if he's got the funding, wants to do it, let's do it. Let's make a magazine.
Yeah, I thought it'd be a neat idea. It's something really to think about, I guess.
Fantastic.
And can you tell us a little bit briefly about what other things WaterisLife does?
Awesome. Yeah. We have probably the most passionate and empowered volunteers and people that work with us. This year, we'll be drilling water wells in cooperation with people that we're working with. I leave in a week for Congo. We're working with Serge Ibaka, one of our NBA players here in Oklahoma City, and he wants to take water back to his home country. So I'll be back in Congo. I was there with him this summer and had an awesome experience. Went to an orphanage, Dr. Carlos, with 900 kids.
900.
Adopted, and we're going back there and drilling a water well for those kids. They don't have clean water. They have to get it from a creek down the hill from where they are.
Wow, it's fabulous.
We've got a team that'll be in Kenya starting next week. We have, I'll be in Congo with another team. We'll be in Ghana, back in Kenya. We'll be in China, India, Ethiopia, Tanzania, back in Congo again, and back in Haiti. We also have some projects that are going on in India and in China as well, working with some different groups and organizations, partnering with them. Some of them are our own projects. But we are looking for strategic partners all the time, people that may need help with maybe an orphanage that they work with or a community that they are passionate about. And we'd love to be able to join hands together with those folks and work together to help solve the global water crisis. Water's life, we don't care whose name's on it, who gets the credit. We just want to help stop the problem. Today, Dr. Carlos, there'll be over 6,000 people die because they don't have clean water. 5,000 of those are kids. So
wow.
One of the cool things that we have is a little straw filter that provides 3 liters of water every day for a child in need. And those little straw filters are $10. You know, what I would pay for a venti coffee and a scone at Starbucks, I can provide water for a child for a year. Gives them 3 liters of water every day. And so I challenge people, say, hey, give that up once a week. By the end of the year, you give that money, that $10 that you'd normally spend on a luxury in your life, 52 people are alive because you were able to make that sacrifice. So lots of cool, innovative technology, everything from straw filter to water treatment plant that'll take care of a village of 1,000 families. And it runs all on solar and wind power. We drill a lot of water wells. We have a home system that provides 1 liter a minute of water. Pretty incredible stuff. So
that's
lots of
fascinating.
Tools. Lots of opportunity there to help a lot of people out.
You're doing some fabulous work, Ken. That really is amazing.
It's been a lot of fun to see the transformation take place. One of the phenomenons that we come across is groups that kind of go in, they're one, they do a project, they're one and done is what I call it. They've come in, they've done it, and then they go and they never come back. Well, they miss out on the greatest thing, and that's seeing the transformation that takes place in these communities. And so we're blessed to be able to go back over and over again, year after year, and be able to touch and impact these lives, but also to see what takes place by just simply adding water to their lives.
And that's the main thing. It's really amazing how much we take that for granted. I mean, I've taken 3 swigs of water just in our little segment alone, and now I can't even not think about those poor children out in those countries. Every time I take a swig of water,
we're headed to a crisis point. We already are in a lot of places out in LA where you guys are at. I mean, that's you guys are struggling with that on a day to day basis. I just heard a great report that in the LA area there was a reduction in like 26% of water usage, which is amazing. But if you put it in perspective, 97% of the water that covers the surface of the earth is salt water. 2% are in the polar ice caps. So that leaves 7.5 billion people competing for 1% of the surface water that's available. And so we're on, as our population continues to increase, that 1% doesn't change. And so it just gets smaller. And so we've got to come up with some innovative, creative ideas to come up with new technology to be able to deal with the world water crisis. One of our partners is a group called Desalinator, and they've come up with a really, really awesome invention of basically using solar power to create distilled water. You can take seawater, you can pee in it, you can take water out of a creek or a stream full of tadpoles, put it in here, and in the course of a day's time, it'll create 5 to 7 gallons of distilled water. It's pretty amazing stuff.
That is amazing. Kent Surratt, everybody, the CEO and founder of Water is Life. You can find him at waterislife.com. Thank you so much again, Ken, for being on the show.
Thank you, Dr. Carlos. Appreciate it. And let us know if there's anything else that we can do to help you out.
Absolutely. Thanks again for all the work you do.
Come on a trip sometime. We'd love to take you with us.
Oh, well, there you go. I'd love to go. Thank you so much again, Ken, for being here.
Okay, thanks a lot, man. Have a great day.
You too. Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Well, there you go, ladies and gentlemen. Water is Life. You can find them at waterislife.com. A fabulous idea to help the people. And he did challenge you, $5 a week. Can you put away that latte for 1 week? I don't know. Think about it. Actually, for 1 day, because it's $5. It is expensive, isn't it? But $5 can save a child's life. Think about that, just because of water. I know I won't be drinking water the same today. So let's look at China for a minute. We're going to head over there. Can air pollution make a fashion statement? Well, I think China is trying to make that claim. Let's find out. Look at this video and see what China has been doing with pollution masks.
There's a new fashion statement hitting Chinese runways, the beautiful smog mask. Fashion designers incorporated the pollution-blocking masks into their designs for Mercedes-Benz China Fashion Week in Beijing, less than 2 weeks after Beijing marathoners donned masks for their 26.2-mile race on October 19th. Earlier this year, the World Health Organization reported that more than 7 million premature deaths worldwide are linked to air pollution each year. Dr. Dor Earborn, an environmental health expert, said that smog has consistently been a problem for industrialized China, whose thick fog of pollution is primarily the result of burning coal.
Welcome back, everyone. I want you to listen to one of our songs that we really love. Why? Because we love the singer, Rebecca Jade. She was a guest on our show last year. And we wanted to give her a tribute, so we're going to have you listen to her song. And right after that, we're going to talk about who's coming on tomorrow's show and the rest of the week. So hang tight.
Cause like a winter tonight. Life into
back, everyone. Isn't she fantastic? I love her. Look her up. Rebecca Jade, J-A-D-E. You can find her on Facebook. Friend her. Say hi to her. Tell her you heard it. You heard her song on Therapy Cable Live. So what's going on for the rest of the week? We're on Hump Day, and tomorrow is Thursday. We have Professor Jervis who's going to come on the show. He's going to be talking about the Middle East. We're going to find out more what's going on out there. We're also going to have Professor Abdullah. He's going to be on the show tomorrow saying, is Sharia law compatible with American values? Well, we're going to find out. As well as the most photographed fitness model in history, Dana Barber Ham, will be on tomorrow at 1:30. Remember, our show starts every day, Monday through Friday, 12 to 2. Friday, we're going to have another great guest, a lineup of guests. We're going to have Megan Barth at 12:30. She's part of the writer and the blogger for Reagan Baby. So she's going to be doing her post-debate analysis on Friday. And she really does not hold back. So you're going to want to hear this one. This one's going to be fun. We're also going to have our weekly economic report at 1 o'clock tomorrow with Stephen, Friday with Stephen Vanelli. He has managed over $500 million in assets. So he's going to be fascinating to hear what he's going to say about this market this week, because it's been struggling. It's been struggling. Only one day up in the last 8 or 9 days of trading. We're also going to have an interview with Faisal Khan from Afghanistan. We're going to find out how the people of Afghanistan view Americans. So that's going to be fascinating as well. Next week, we have so many shows, great shows. I can't even keep up with them, but I'll give you a couple highlights. We're going to talk to David Clohessy. He's going to be talking about sexual abuse in the Catholic Church. We're also going to have Olympic athlete going to be on the show as well, Cassie Highworth. She's going to be on here next week. We're going to have supermodel Ashton Taylor is going to be here, a model and actress Caitlin O'Connor, David Kilgore, the former Secretary of State of Asia. Can you believe it? We just have a lot of stuff going on. And I don't know what other surprises. Who knows? But stay tuned. Remember, Monday through Friday, you can tweet us your questions or your thoughts at TC Live News. You can also call us at 949-242-9720. Monday through Friday, 12 to 2. Find us on therapycable.com or YouTube. Look for Therapy Cable Live. I hope you enjoyed today's show, and I hope you're learning as we're going to go through a series in the upcoming days and weeks about how our unconscious mind really influences us. Let me give you a brief summary before we go. Our unconscious mind is created by our past experiences, past associations, and past relationships. These influence how we see the world today. Believe it or not, things that happen to you at 4, 5, 6, 7 years old do have an impact. And they can influence how you live today, the decisions you make, how much money you make, who you date and who you marry, and a lot of hosts of other things. A host of other things, and you're going to check that out, and you're going to learn about these individual things and factors that influence you each and every day. We're going to continue to expand on them. Tomorrow, I'm going to touch on the psychology of color. And what does that do? And I'll tell you one little secret. A lot of psychologists, well, I can't say a lot, but there is quite a number of psychologists that get jobs in marketing firms and advertising agencies to make sure they can utilize color and other techniques to access our unconscious. That's true. They're helping these agencies to make you buy their product. Kind of fascinating, isn't it? 12 to 2, Monday through Friday, Therapy Cable Live. Catch us.